Kia ora whānau. Hey, thanks so much for inviting us into your home and your bubble and your living room or wherever you're watching this from this morning. It's a joy to be able to gather as a scattered church in this season of lockdown, right? And we know that lockdown finds us in the whole range of situations and emotions. Among us as a church are those for whom lockdown has come at a really rough time. We think of Colin and Leonie, who were supposed to be getting married this afternoon, who have had to postpone that. We think of others who are managing illnesses and are now managing that illness from within their bubble. Many people quickly on Tuesday relocated to support family or to have family move in with them, have rearranged their households to be a bubble together. And that brings its own challenges. It brings its own new routines. Right through on the spectrum to those of you who actually really enjoy lockdown and actually really enjoy the change of pace and the slowness and this quiet. I don't know about you, but my neighbourhood is really quiet at the moment. And so we find ourselves as a church across that full spectrum of situations and across that full spectrum of emotions, and that is okay. It's totally okay. And so wherever you find yourself this morning, whatever lockdown is for you and however you're experiencing it, we want you to know that we are praying for you. We want you to know that we're available by phone and email and video call. If you need support, if you need a listening ear, if you just need a bit of empathy or prayer, as I say, we can absolutely do that over the phone. So very much available to you guys. Hope that it's going okay. Someone from the church should have checked in with you by now. Hopefully you've heard from one of us, and hopefully you're receiving our emails as well. But anyway, as we come to worship this morning, I want to read to you as a call to worship from actually one of my favorite passages of the scripture. It's part lament and it's part praise, and I think that's appropriate in the situation we find ourselves in this morning. It comes from Habakkuk 3, starting at verse 17, and it says this: though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Saviour. The Sovereign Lord is my strength. Would you join us as we worship this morning, even in lockdown, even in the circumstances we find ourselves in?
Oh,
By way of notices this morning, we just want to reiterate that we are available by phone, by email, by video call. If you need some pastoral care, we can do that remotely. If you need prayer, we can do that remotely. Do reach out if you need some support. The other notice I want to just make sure everybody's aware of, if you have not been receiving emails from us, first and foremost, check your junk folder. Apparently some of the church-wide emails have gone into junk folders. We apologize for that. Please do check your junk folder first and foremost. If you're still not receiving emails from us, please get in contact and let us know your email address. The reality is we may not have it right, or we may not have it at all. We think we've got most people's. But if you are not receiving emails from us, do get in touch and we'll see if we can't resolve that. Email is the primary way where we will be communicating updates, communicating what's going on. As we get information, we'll be sharing it with you. And so do keep an eye on your inboxes. And if you're not getting those emails, do get in touch, do get in contact with us. For prayer this morning, I want to read to you a prayer that you will have heard me read before. It's one of my favorites, from a book called Gorillas of Grace by a guy called Ted Loader. And I just think it's so appropriate for this moment that we find ourselves in. And so let's take a moment to pray together. O God, gather me now to be with you as you are with me. Soothe my tiredness. Quiet my fretfulness, curb my aimlessness, relieve my compulsiveness. Let me be easy for a moment. O Lord, release me from the fears and guilts which grip me so tightly, from the expectations and opinions which I so tightly grip, that I may be open to receiving what you give, to risking something genuinely new, to learning something refreshingly different. O God, gather me to be with you as you are with me. Keep me in touch with myself, with my needs, my anxieties, my angers, my pains, my corruptions, that I may claim them as my own rather than blame them on someone else. O Lord, deepen my wounds into wisdom. Shape my weaknesses into compassion, gentle my envy into enjoyment, my fear into trust, my guilt into honesty, my accusing fingers into tickling ones. O God, gather me to be with you as you are with me. Amen.
Oh,
been following the news lately, but if you have, even before we went into lockdown, if you believed what a lot of the reports were saying, then they were suggesting actually that it was all looking really kind of grim. I mean, the UN report on climate change came out, and what it basically said was, guys, it's gonna get kind of bad. Even if we stop all emissions today or tomorrow, it's going to take 30 years, this report said, for things to turn around for our planet. Brace yourself, this report said, basically, because weather and climate and extreme events, they're all gonna get kind of bad. And then there's the housing market. With house prices continuing to skyrocket, many have been saying that actually at this point, it doesn't really matter which way it goes, it's going to be less than ideal. If house prices continue escalating, then the gap between rich and poor is just going to continue to increase. On the other end of the scale, if house prices falter and there's some sort of crash, then people may well end up in the situation where they have negative equity, where the amount of money they owe on the house is more than the house is now actually worth. What these reports were basically saying is, guys, it's gonna get kind of bad. And then, well, then there's COVID, right? Even before Delta came to our shores, even before our current lockdown, we were getting reports from all over the world about just how bad this was. Lockdown, nations in lockdown, sometimes for months. And we were getting reports even before this current lockdown that you know what? If it makes it to our shores, guys, it could be really bad. And here we are in lockdown, with COVID and the Delta variant here in Auckland. I mean, over and over again, in all kinds of areas, we've been being told, guys, it just might get really bad. And yet, I am utterly persuaded that as Christians, our hope is real, our joy is entirely possible, and that love will win. I am persuaded that now more than ever before, Christians are being called to be a non-anxious presence in our world. And so today, I hope you'll indulge me. I just kind of want to share my heart, actually. Share something of a journey that I've been on with this stuff. We're still in our final week of our Emotionally Healthy Relationships series. And incidentally, though, this isn't at all what I'd planned for today's sermon at the end of the series. It actually overlaps perfectly, has the same heart and the same intent and the same outcome, I think. I shared some weeks ago about Psalm 23, and to be honest, it was my preparation for that sermon that kind of started me down the track that I want to share with you today. I, like so many of you, had read Psalm 23 like a bazillion times, and I, like so many of you, thought I knew it well and had studied it completely, sort of thing. And I, like so many of you, had that moment, had that experience where you experience a verse that you think you know as if you were reading it for the very first time, as if you've never read it before. That happened to me in my preparation for that sermon a few weeks ago. The final section of Psalm 23 says, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." And it hit me as I read that, and as I shared a few weeks ago, if we're dining in the presence of our enemies, then we're probably going to know their name. And sure, that can be people, I hope not, but we all do have people that we kind of sort of see as our enemy if we're really brutally honest. But in today's day and age, it can also be so much more than that, actually. Loneliness can be an enemy, can it not? anxiety is an enemy. And I mean, I do want to put a disclaimer on this bit, because anxiety is also a serious illness which needs to be treated, and I in no way want to undermine or overlook or minimize that. But I use the term anxiety today simply to mean that low level kind of anxiety that we all experience from time to time. Stress is another one of those enemies. When experienced over a long period of time, stress does incredible harm to our bodies. It is responsible for all kinds of ailments and illnesses. And yet stress is simply our perception that the circumstances exceed our resources, be that time resources or energy resources or capacity resources or ability resources. Stress is so often seen as an enemy. And COVID, of course, no doubt, is an enemy. People are never the enemy. People who get COVID are never the enemy. But the virus, that's an enemy. And it brings with it so many other unwanted realities, doesn't it? We are surrounded by enemies. And the Christian life is this image of acknowledging the real and present danger all around us that we are surrounded with. And yet finding the ability to feast even within that. It's acknowledging reality, not shying away from it, being committed to it, in fact, while also resting in the knowledge and the presence of the sovereign Lord, who is the one who prepares a feast for us, even in the middle of our chaos, even in the middle of all these enemies. Christian life is about finding the ability to say, surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life. Finding the ability to live with faith and hope and love, even while acknowledging that it is really bad out there. And so this morning we simply ask the question, how do we do it? I mean, if that's the image, if the image of life in and with Christ that the psalmist is painting is feasting in the presence of our enemies, how do we get there? How do we experience that? How do we live that? 1 Corinthians 13:13 says, and now these three remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love. And I am persuaded, friends, that if we are going to get to the kind of life depicted by the psalmist, then we are going to have to lean into faith and hope and love. We're going to have to understand them in really tangible ways. We're going to have to understand them in really biblical ways and live them out, not only in our lives, but influencing others with faith and with hope and with love. And so let's look at each one of those individually. Faith. I have come to believe that the opposite of faith is not actually doubt, it's control. At its heart, faith is simply trusting in God, right? And trusting in God requires at least a degree of giving up control. Now, please hear me. There is a really healthy version of control. There's a really healthy kind of control that we all can and should and do have control over. We can and should and do have control over our time and our schedule and our choices. In fact, that's the kind of healthy control that dates all the way back to Genesis, where before the fall, God invited humans to fill the earth and to rule over it, to subdue it. He did so not to encourage dominance, but rather to establish that part of being human is a really healthy and appropriate stewardship mandate. It comes with a healthy and appropriate level of control that we have over our lives and our environment. But outside of that good and appropriate and healthy control that hopefully we all have, that comes as part of God's good world, control can and does come with a shadow side, doesn't it? Control can and does mean that we can stop trusting in God and start trusting in ourselves. Control can mean that we manage and we micromanage not just our worlds, but those people in our worlds. Control can and does mean that every news article and every COVID outbreak and every COVID update and every bad news story sends us into a tailspin of buying toilet paper and excessively reading the news over and over again and just over-functioning generally. Control can mean that we leave the metaphorical table, right? And we move away from the feast. We move away from what God has prepared for us. And we spend less time in prayer and we spend less time sitting in the presence of God. And instead we start figuring out how we can build a fence or defend our space or retreat away from those enemies that feel so very close. And I don't know about you, but this is something I do actually struggle with from time to time. I really like control. I like to be able to manage my world. I like predictable. And I have found actually that one of the most powerful things I can do in the middle of uncertain times, in the middle of the temptation to always be reaching for control instead of reaching for faith, is to pray a one-line prayer that I have stolen from a much longer prayer. I am not clever enough to memorize the whole prayer, but I can manage to remember one line of it, and it seems to be enough. It seems to be good for me, at least. And the prayer requires you to stop for a minute and just kind of notice what's going on inside of you and around you. Some would call it mindfulness, some would call it simply paying attention, but you take a moment to stop and to notice what's going on inside of you, what's going on around you, what are you experiencing, what are you feeling, and then you simply say to God, God, help me to embrace and fully live this moment as it actually is. And that's it. God, help me to embrace and fully live this moment as it actually is. That one prayer, that one line, that one moment can and does flip me from reaching for control to noticing the beauty that's right there in the middle of the reality of that moment. That one prayer, that one line, that one moment, it flips me from being in charge and reminds me again that God is in charge. That one prayer, that one line, that one moment, it flips me from being in control mode to being in faith mode. I encourage you to try it. I really do, especially in the middle of this season. In fact, for all of you overachievers out there, there is an extra credit version where you change the prayer to be, help me to accept and love this person as they really are. Christianity, after all, is all about invitation and relationship and never coercion. God changes hearts, not us. But I skip ahead. We're not up to the love bit yet. Stay with me. So there's faith. And there's hope. My husband, Tim, has a new hobby, actually. For his birthday, he got an old school film camera. I can't tell you what it is because I don't really know anything at all about photography, but this is it. Tim restored it and overhauled it and is now using it. And I have to say that Tim's new hobby has become my new spiritual discipline. Because unlike digital cameras, when you're using film, you really, really slow down. You can't just take 10 photos and analyze them and decide which is the best one of them and then delete 9 of them. You really think about your shot. You really take notice of the moments. You really pay attention when you're using film. We've been going for walks with this camera, and not only does photography encourage you to walk slowly and to take lots of lovely long pauses to take in the beauty, It's also an exercise in patience and hope. You can't immediately check that the photo you've taken is awesome. You can't immediately see if your hair was perfect or the light was right, but you can wait. And you can hope. You can wait and you can hope that the moments and the slowing and the noticing will all add up to something truly beautiful in the future in the form of a printed photo. 1 Peter 1:3 says, "Praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, fade, or spoil." Jesus offers a living hope, one that is imperishable, one that is good for all of eternity, one that assures us actually that the moments we create can and will add up to something really beautiful in the future. Jesus offers a living hope, one that won't fade like so many of our other hopes. Jesus offers a living hope that is good for today and tomorrow and for the very real realities that we all find ourselves in. When Jesus was here and he was teaching his disciples and the people in a really very well-known verse, yet another that we think we've heard a billion times before and we think we know, he said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon me and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." It is fascinating to me that Jesus realizes the best rest and the best hope he can give us is not an escape, and it's not a magic wand, and it's not an instant fix to all the world's problems. The best tool that Jesus can give us is a way of carrying life that is sustainable over the long haul. A way of doing the work of stewardship that isn't burdensome. A way of doing life that embraces hope, that embraces the real realities that the moments and the noticing and the slowing can and do add up to something beautiful, if not now, then at least in the future. Faith and hope and love. And here we circle back to the very passage that we started with. In fact, we circle back to what came right before the pronouncement that faith and hope and love remain. And you'll notice actually that it's yet another really well-known verse. We're working with a bit of a theme here, the often quoted well-known verses. This one's often quoted at weddings. So again, Colin and Leonie, we are thinking of you today. We are praying for you today as we can't gather to celebrate your wedding. But again, 1 Corinthians 13 says, "If I speak in the tongues of men or angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but does not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but I do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient and kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor one another. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres." And friends, this is where the rubber really hits the road. This is where faith and hope get put into practice. Because love is not compatible with control. And love is not compatible with fear, and love is not compatible with no hope for the future, and love is not compatible with a lack of trust. Rather, love is an invitation, not coercion, never coercion. Love is active, but it's never reactive. And here in the middle of lockdown, how we need to remember that love is active, but it's never reactive. Friends, here in the middle of a global pandemic and a local lockdown, love looks like staying at home. It looks like ringing your neighbors and your friends and your family and checking in on them. It looks like not hoarding and not panic buying. It looks like slowing down a little and embracing the moments as they really are, not as we would like them to be. It looks like trusting that those moments will add up to something beautiful in the future. It looks like embracing a way of life that is sustainable. It looks like treating your bubble mates in all the ways that the Bible says characterize love, interacting with them with kindness, with patience, in a way that honors the other, and in a way that doesn't keep record of the wrongs, interacting with them in a way that protects and trusts and hopes and perseveres. Love always protects, the Bible says, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. How we need those things in this moment, in this season, don't we? Guys, friends, I realize it all looks pretty bad out there. But take heart, because these three things remain. Faith and hope and love. But the greatest of these is love. Kia kaha, friends. My prayer for you in this season is that you, like the psalmist, would be able to pray to God that you prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my oil, my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. May it be that you and I and all of us practice and lean into faith and hope and love. Amen. Thank you. this morning with the grace that we often end our services with, the spoken blessing that we say at the end of a service. And I encourage you, wherever you are, to say it out loud. There's something really powerful about speaking out a blessing to those in your bubble, to those around you, joining with the rest of us in our bubbles as we speak out that same blessing, that same prayer. And so many of you will know the words. Let's say it together. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and always. Amen.